We pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, infinite, and eternal, for all.
Please bow.
Please stand.
Our God and Father in heaven, we're so grateful that we could come to you tonight in good health and discuss the things that pertain to the life, wealth, and health of our city. We ask you to be with us in our judgments, in our reasoning, in our attention, and our courtesy, that the things that come before us will be done righteously and justly, and that the progress of this city might continue as we hope that it'll be for future generations down through the years. We ask you, especially tonight, to be with our government as we deal with the various conflicts and the issues that are going on around the world. We ask them to hope that they will remember that you are in charge, and we put our trust and confidence in you to take care of us. Be with us now tonight as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Need to get a motion to amend the agenda to add proclamation for 2013.
Motion.
I'll make a motion to amend the agenda to add that proclamation.
Get a second.
I second.
All in favor say aye.
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 Yep, y'all.
Approval of minutes from March 7th, 2013 meeting.
Make a motion to approve. Get a second.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Get down.
Public comment for items not on the agenda.
It's April once again. The month of our yearly Carrabelle Riverfront Festival. This year marks the 23rd annual festival, and Carrabelle Cares has been busy coordinating on behalf of the city this year's festival. I'd like to make a special mention of some of your contractors who have been very generous and support of the festival the last few years. Anovia Consulting Group has been one of our sponsors for the past 3 years. CDM, your Dermot Roddenberry, Dan Parkman, and others that I'll let you know about later on have been supportive sponsors. So we really appreciate that. It helps us put together a festival that we can all be proud of. This year, the major change is a timing thing where we're gonna hold the festival on Friday night from 4 to 8 p.m. and then follow it with a day of family fun from 9 to 5 p.m. on Saturday. And we won't be having a festival on Sunday this year. We have what looks to be a very exciting festival planned and are working hard to make that happen. Everybody be sure and dust off your pirate costumes. Make sure they're mended and fit you and you're ready to wear them down there and come celebrate and have fun. Any questions? Thank you.
I'm for it.
All right.
Any other public comments? Commissioner's report, Commissioner Mathis.
I have none.
Commissioner LaPaz?
Yes, I would first like to thank the city clerk for providing the commissioners with the budget, the quarterly budget reports, and the general fund report and the water and sewer fund. On the 11th, I attended, along with Commissioner Allen and Commissioner Schneider and Mr. Butler from the EDC and four other representatives from Carrabelle, we went to the Franklin County Long-Term Economic Diversification Summit. And there were over 60 leaders there who participated in that workshop. And everyone agreed on the need for diversification to sustain new areas of development in Franklin County for the future. So I'm not going to say any more on that. In the event Commissioner Allen or Commissioner Schneider would like to report on that a little bit.
I would like to report on that. That was the economic opportunity is also a part of the ARPC that I attend every 2 months. up in Tallahassee, Apalachicola Regional.
Planning.
Appalachian Regional Planning Commission.
Yeah.
Of seven states, that includes our neighboring counties all the way over to Jefferson County. And you had a great report on that from Mr. Chris, and from that I added that that was undoubtedly one of the best meetings that I've ever attended from the standpoint of, we got out on time, the speakers were held to a timekeeper, they stayed on topic, and it was all moderated in a very excellent way, and I don't mind going to meetings like that. And a lot was accomplished. The overall picture of it was that what this county is about is its people, its natural settings, that both the water and the land, and the old-time Florida atmosphere. And it was pointed out that that being our biggest asset, that's where we're going to stand, have the best opportunity. And anything that would destroy that or take away from it would absolutely destroy that which we have. So there is development, and we need development, we need jobs, but it all has to be done in connection with preserving the pristine quality of the city.
Okay, well, I just wanted to also continue on. On the 22nd, I went to the full-day workshop in Orlando for reuse water, and that workshop was for elected officials, and it was focused on improving public awareness and acceptance of reuse water. And they were emphasizing that reuse water is economic and safe and ongoing source of water that will extend our fresh water supplies into the future. Reuse also gives an alternative to costly drinking water for your watering of your yards and your cars. Now, of course, we don't have a lot of reuse water here because we have a small population. But in South Florida, most of the people that attended were from South Florida. And they have, their cities are riddled with reuse pipes. In Southern Florida, they're injecting water. They have what they call injection wells, and they're injecting reuse water back into the deep aquifers for use in future years, say 20 or 30 years down the road, because those cities down there are just running, the aquifers are just running so dry. And Palm Beach County has actually created two passive wetland parks out of their spray fields. They're injecting reuse water into the aquifer, into the ground next to their spray fields, and they have beautiful wetlands parks that are look just like from natural water, but they're reuse water with all of the plant life and bird life and animal life that you see in a regular wetland. And our water and sewer managers here are very motivated about the production of reuse water to be a cost savings for the citizens of Carrabelle and reduce the environmental impact on our Floridian aquifer. If we could just have a larger population so we could have the opportunity to develop more reuse, but we're working towards it. And then on the 28th, I attended the first meeting of the Franklin County Restore Act Council, and I'm the representative for the County District 5. So I won't report on that meeting. Our mayor represents Carrabelle on that council, so I'll defer to him for his report on that meeting. And then I just wanted to say, when I submitted my fuel receipts for the trip to Atlanta, Orlando, I was given an opportunity to either have a reimbursement for mileage for 56.5 cents a mile, or just reimburse me for my fuel cost. And that kind of caught me off guard. I didn't really, you know that was going to happen. I was explained to me by the finance director, the city does not have a policy for commissioners on that. And there is a policy for the city employees, they get 56.5 cents per mile. So I'm going to ask to have a little spot on the agenda next month that maybe we can discuss and decide, you know, if we need to have a policy for the commission, whether to be reimbursed straight out for the fuel cost or for the mileage rate. And so that'll give our attorney some time to kind of research that and give us some time to think about it. And then I wanted to ask Mr. Hartman Well, we have a representative tomorrow at the Gulf Consortium meeting in Tallahassee. Okay. All right, very good then.
Yes, I'll attend. It's right, it's 2 blocks from my office downtown, so I'll walk over with Commissioner Allen.
Okay, thank you.
I've already prepared.
And I'll give a little, because now that report, I can give you a little heads up on what we expect.
Thank you.
Commissioner Schneider?
No, I'm good.
Commissioner Allen?
Just a couple of things. I don't know how many of you know, we have a new fire station in town out at the airport. And it's sort of squoze in between two of the hangars. That's past tense of squeeze, by the way. And it's just enough room to back in our big number three. And the advantage of that is that anybody within 5 miles of a fire station gets a rating of 5 for their fire insurance. And if you're outside that, it's $9. It's a rating of 9, which is considerably almost double for fire insurance. So that area there completely takes in the Lighthouse Estates and will be a big advantage of that. Plus the fact that it puts something on the other side of the river in case there's a blockage on the bridge. And it can also be accessible and available for East Point or any other fire that happens in the county on that side of the river. So we're real proud of that. It's a nice little building. It's a metal building, and it went up quick. I'm able to get in and look at it from the inside, and it's real nice. We also have been notified that there is some money available for hazard mitigation. This has to do with disasters and the expenses that we might pay to fix a roof or rebuild a street or anything like that. There's a number of areas that come under that, and it's a result of storms. And this particular case here, it's limited or deals with the storm Isaac. And one of the projects that we're looking at, I believe, Courtney, is our roof here on this building, and being able to offset some of the cost of that. And there's a lot of criteria for it, a lot of hoops they have to jump through to get it, and it'll be administered by and through the county. So we're looking forward to that and anything else that might come up that we can go back and approve and pay for.
I wanted to ask a question about that. Mm-hmm. And I believe that Mr. Waddell has submitted an application for that, hasn't he?
That was from Debbie.
Debbie, okay.
And pretty much the county already ate most of that money up.
Okay, so, all right.
But they did say they had money out of this one that they haven't used.
Right. Very good.
This was sort of a surprise. I got a call from Pam Brownell over at the Emergency Operations Center the other night after work, and she informed me of it, and we put it right in line in the pot with Courtney, and so they're working on that. Thank you. That's all I have.
Mayor Messer?
Not at this time.
Staff report. I'm going to ask that the City Commission set up a workshop to discuss the water and sewer debts and how we're going to repay, and I think we need to sit down and talk about the different funding sources or different revenue, ways to produce revenue. And do y'all have a date y'all would like to do that? Y'all have a date that don't work for y'all?
How far away are we?
Courtney,
2 weeks?
Me and Courtney both coach our daughter's softball team, so if we could do it on a Wednesday possibly, that'd be great.
Okay.
Would you want to put it off until May?
I think it'd be good.
That would give us some time to gather up some more information.
Yeah. Or that's good. We're done with softball after May 10th.
So. Oh, well, now how about that?
First,
we don't go to state.
Oh.
Yeah, first or third or fourth Wednesdays are open for me in May.
The 15th?
Right.
But anytime in May, I'm going to do a Tuesday or Monday so that we didn't conflict with church night.
And we all figured out the date, what you...
How about May 14th?
When you want to call it?
Just looking at your calendar.
May 14th. May 14th is a Tuesday.
It's a Tuesday.
Uh-huh. We'll be done by then.
It's been too much this year hassle going and not asking me about special meetings. You got to go to them, and I'm for it. Don't misunderstand me, but I want to be recognized in my job.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I mean?
Oh, yes.
But I definitely wanted to call for a special meeting except an emergency. Now, an emergency, like a hurricane or something, I can call that at an instant. But according to the charter, and we don't want to go against the charter because you do, you're breaking the law.
How does May 14th sound to you, Mr. Mayor?
That sounds good to me.
Okay, that gives us, well, 6 weeks in advance.
All right, I'll call a meeting for that.
5 o'clock, okay?
If it's all right with the mayor.
That's true. I just wanted y'all to know we don't want to break the law.
You're right about that.
And we've been a break. In other words, we ain't been asked. We have not asked. And you know what I mean?
We got it. We understand.
I just want everybody to understand it.
I hope that Mr. Hartman makes sure we're not breaking the law.
Well,
I know he does.
He knows. Maybe just a motion to set the special meeting.
I'm going to make a motion.
Is it going to be a special meeting or a workshop?
It'll be a workshop.
You're talking two different things now.
Yeah, sorry, a workshop. This is a workshop, May 14th, 5 o'clock, on water and sewer funding alternatives.
Can I get a motion to that?
I made the motion.
I second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Hit gone. That's my man tonight now.
Carol already alluded to the hazard mitigation funding, and we'll be coordinating with the city also to find out if there's other projects that may be eligible from a stormwater standpoint or a roadway improvement standpoint. So we'll be coordinating with the staff on that. Keogh's addition. Plans are complete. The permit has been issued by the Water Management District. There were some wetland impacts associated with that project, but we met with DEP. And fortunately, they have determined that the city is not liable for any of those impacts that were done associated with that project. So construction is complete. Permits are issued. We've got a price from the contractor. However, their price is more than the remaining budget from the stormwater grant. But there are parts of the project we think that they can build and remain within the budget. And we're going to negotiate with them and try to get the critical parts of the drainage elements of that job constructed with those grant funds. That may be a project that's also eligible through the hazard mitigation grant funding. So we'll investigate that as well. The work must be complete on that project by June 30th.
We're going to bid that out?
No, that was that's a change order to the contractor already selected in the stormwater grant.
Which was Hale?
Yeah.
Hale Contracting? Who was the contractor?
Hale. We met with the Water Management District regarding funding for water and sewer projects. Official funding request has been made to the legislature and DEP and the Water Management District. Inovia also met with Halsey Bashiers, who was very supportive of our application. So we'll monitor that and advise you accordingly. Lastly, won't talk too much about it because it's on your agenda, but you have a resolution for you for a joint project agreement between the City of Carrabelle and the Department of Transportation for a grant in the amount of $125,000 for beautification along Highway 9. So I know, Mayor Minister, you're happy to see that arrive. Just to let you know that the grant and construction, everything needs to be complete on or before April 30th, 2014. So that gives us a year to complete that project. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
I have a question. Are you going to be utilizing Carrabelle's new landscape ordinance?
Yes.
So there'll be native plants?
Yes, we will.
Low maintenance, low water use?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Yes, and in fact, we have a plan to extend reuse water for where irrigation is necessary.
And then will those reuse pipes go the entire length of the landscaping, or will there be funding for that?
Right, but notwithstanding the budget, yes.
That come my beautification.
Yes, sir. So, okay, that's, and I know we may not have reuse water at this point for it, but it's a symbol, and a symbol to the water management district that we're working along those lines.
That's right.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Waterfront Partnership.
Good evening, everybody. Unfortunately, I can't report that I'm bringing you a whole lot of money tonight. I can tell you that we have very efficiently used $50,000 of the state of Florida's historic preservation money to complete the phase one renovations to the old city hall. And I want to invite everybody to stop by and look at it. We have a totally brand new electrical system, and I will no longer have to pray for the building every night that it won't burn down before morning. We have upgraded the power boxes and the wires, and we've gotten rid of all the cloth covered wires and other things that were in there that were just scary as all get out. And we actually have light switches that work, and you can turn off a light in a room and it doesn't turn off all your computers and peripherals. I mean, it's like we've died and gone to heaven. Plus, it looks nice. The track lighting in the museum rooms is very, very attractive. And everybody that's been in there today is remarked about it, even strangers, so that's great. There also, we've renovated the bathrooms into one, combined two small bathrooms into one. Wheelchair accessible and compliant, code compliant bathroom, and we've also renovated the front, which you probably all have driven by and seen. There's now an appropriate code compliant ramp and handrails and so forth, and it looks really nice. So we're very tickled about that, and it is phase one, and we're hopeful that we'll be able to put in just as soon as it comes around again for phase two and phase three to finish fixing the building. But we feel like this was a great start. Our environmental team has been working on progress, made good progress for increasing the multimodal path, which is essentially the bike path for all vehicles. From the lighthouse up to the RV park, we're now working on plans and beginning on the to the Tilly Miller Bridge, and we're continuing to find funding sources for it. We want to connect up with other bike trails and other pathways that are going on around in the region, and we're also continuing to explore funding for the removal of invasive plant species from our various water, those creeks, drains, and holding ponds all have a lot of problems with invasive plants, and we're coming up with some ways to fund that. And we're also looking for ways to fund some of the numerous just hydrology water quality issues that are involved with the city that complement the ones that are already going on. There's a cleanup of Patton Park on Saturday morning at 8 o'clock. 9 o'clock. Oh, my dear, I told everybody 8 o'clock. 9 o'clock on Saturday morning out at Patton Park. We've got some wonderful assistance from the Sea Oaks Garden Club, as well as the Audubon Society and local volunteers, and you're all invited to come out and help help shape up Patton Park. And then the following Saturday morning at 8 o'clock, and that one is at 8 o'clock, we have a cleanup for Carrabelle River that we do annually in April. And it's on the 13th this year, and you'll have plenty of time to come clean up the river and then go to the Worm Grinding Festival. So stop by and do that first. We're meeting at the pavilion down by the waterfront of the fishing pavilion. Our hazard mitigation team is participating tomorrow with an effort for volunteers active in disasters, and we're working with people from around the county and trying to learn how to handle some of those things, and there'll be other training available as we go along. For the city will have some because of being an official hazard mitigation, after the storm center, I forget the name of that. But there'll be some training but also the community volunteers and the food banks are getting trained as well. So all of that's leading up to having a very well-prepared community for the hurricane, upcoming hurricanes, and also for other potential disasters. As we all know, it's just, could be almost anything these days. The public access team has been working on various funding sources for the planned, long-standing plan for improvements to the 4th Street boat ramp, and we're trying to blend that with the public relations kiosk that we're already working through the TDC and the Chamber of Commerce, and hopefully those two things can come together and not only make a very attractive location, but one that will cause people to stop and learn about both our seafood and potential fishing destination and what kind of fish you can catch and so forth, but then we'll also learn about our on land type of tourism issues and birds and butterflies and animals and so forth. So we kind of got that going along as a two-part project for the 4th Street area. And then Mr. David has been organizing, David Butler, our economic development team, has been organizing things, and you can hear those things from him, but that's all came from part of our plan. So our next meeting is April 10th at the library, not April, I did say April, but it's May 10th at the library, and we'd be glad to have anybody come to any of our meetings that you'd like to. Anybody have any questions?
Thank you, ma'am.
What time on May 10th?
May 10th we meet from 3:30 to 5 is our scheduled time.
And the city hall wrote through that one today.
Thank you. Your brother came to see inside the museum today, and he seemed to be very impressed.
Yeah, he's quite a dude wanting to get around like that.
Yeah, they went all through it for quite a bit of time here, so I told him to go home and give you a good report.
You what? Tell me in the morning I had to eat breakfast and get conduct. I said, that's good enough.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
EDC?
I brought it here. Can I have that?
Excellent. Because my name was changed over there.
I only have a couple of pages. Won't take long. First of all, I'd like to thank the city for the support for the Camberon Johnson Reunion. Again, it was an excellent event. As we cut back the food that we've done in the past, it was not an impact. I regret to state that the active duty soldiers were not able to attend either the land base that drove up nor the landing craft, the LCU 2000 craft. So, as you know, there's a lot of stuff going on. They're sequestering, and everybody was hit hard on that. So. And for the city's impact, we had our dinner dance here, and the board is considering not doing the dinner dance here because we had just limited tables around the edge of the cafeteria, and it's just, we don't need that size of the space. So it's not because it's not a perfect place, and we appreciate it being made available. Even the caterers, it's not even functional to have that small of an event catered for the price that we were being given.
Well, you never know, do you? When, how many are coming and when they don't?
Yeah, we've never had luck with people reserving, so it's really when they come in on Friday to register, only then do we know how many we're going to have. And of course, we've already had to have plans. Food has to be purchased ahead of time for the catering. So anyway, I'm just letting you know, it's not, if it does occur, it's not for lack of trying and everybody's support, and we do appreciate it. And of course, the parade, you know, I wish we had a color guard parade, but that fell through at the last minute. So we had horses for the first time. I had to do double duty. I had to do the flag and clean up the horses.
I understand there's going to be a lot more.
I tell them, we're a small town. We put multiple hats on. We do everything we have to. That's all there is to it. And just a quick note on the Franklin County Long-Term Economic Development Summit, which was an excellent meeting, DEO. I've done the other strategic planning sessions with them, and they seem to be tightening it up and getting more specific with it. I met with the executive director, Jesse Panicio, I can't pronounce his name, but I met with him and his aide, and I even asked for a special meeting to try to get something here for a testing. We have people that go on unemployment when they lose a job, and we have 30 buildings available. And I imagine we can get some buildings for nothing, I mean, just to get jobs created. And if you look at how much they get paid, if we could give them a job where they're earning an income and then have the workforce come here to train them on getting a resume made and so they can get a job that they want, maybe we can help them from both ends of creating jobs and keeping people off of the cash assistance. So I've yet to hear back from them, but at least it was a thought. I would like to request the city's influence with the county on our capital city to the sea loop. We have approved a resolution for that. It went before the county Tuesday, and there were some things that we need to get more information to them, like who's going to maintain the bike path after it's built, and the other is impact on hunting leases and so forth. And we will have those, the folks who are working on the GFNA bike trail, will have that at the meeting. But by all means, it'll be here at 10 o'clock on April 16th, and anything the city can do to support that, because of course both of the bike paths coming from 98 across Oklahoma Bay and across the bridge at 319, all paths lead to Carrabelle, and they're going to end up on the pavilion here. So we need the county support in this, and I'm sure that we can take care of all the concerns that are being asked for us to bring to that meeting. The EDC also would appreciate any updates on the Restore Act. We don't have anybody on our EDC that will be attending any of the major meetings, but anything you get, any emails you can send, I'll send that around to the members and anybody that has an email address that's on our EDC participants list so they can share in that.
David?
Yes.
On that bike path, are they considering staying on 98 or will they come down that C30?
Well, that's to be determined. We have to have support for saying we want it, but you have to have consultants and engineers that are hired that will do the master planning, and they will come here and hold a meeting where you and anyone else from the public can come in here and say, you know, I really don't want it over here, and here are the reasons why, and I do want it here because that has the best view and so forth. It's a long process. But all we're trying to do, once you get the resolutions, then we have to go to District 3, Florida Department of Transportation, to get funding, transportation funding, to do the planning. And, you know, Restore Act, I have hopes that there will be other things that we can get funded because they all impact our economic development. The Big Bend Scenic Byway brings stuff to us, you know, so forth. So we hope we can do that. So stay tuned. They'll be announced in the paper.
David, Suzanne Zimmerman on
your right.
She's actually on the county restore council.
So she'll be able to do that. I'm sorry, I didn't think about that.
And you'll also be able to see those on the Half Shell web forum, the County Restore Act meetings, and then that I believe they're going to attempt to go to the consortium meetings and film those.
Film those as well. Great, so we'll have that as well. Yes. So, but I guess the executive summary version of it. And of course, if there's anything that EDC can do to get any information together from, you know, the Chamber of Commerce and so forth, we stand ready to, sometimes we sit, and we stand ready to help you. The TDC, I was informed by Chester Reese on the board that the TDC had voted to increase their TDC tax that they use for promoting Franklin County Carrabelle from 2% to 4%. And there'll be, I'm sure there'll be some public meetings and stuff, and they'll have an effective date sometime in the future. But they're fixing to move to getting more funds in here to support activities that we do to bring people here, but also to reach people very far away to tell them what we have here so they can come enjoy it, and then hopefully they'll go home.
David, I can talk to that a little bit. Yes, sir. Can you see that is a user tax? It's only paid by the people to stay here, the visitors coming into town.
Yeah.
We are right now the lowest tax, the bed tax in the entire state. Places like Miami go up as much as 12 cents per, or 12% for their tax. And,
and our neighbors are at 5 and 6% around us here.
And so around here, and Bay County and so these major tourist areas, it's up around 5. So right. We'll still be under.
So we'll still be under the other folks here. So it's not like we're going to cause any problems with other people coming here or to Bay County. We're still going to be more affordable.
It should double the amount of money we'll have to spend on promotions and advertising of the county. And right now we're getting more applications for grants than we have money for. So we're looking forward to that as a win-win for everybody.
Okay. Down to my last two items. Of course, we've been working with the Gulf Unmanned System Center project and trying to, you know, get something put in the hex report, and that's one of the most viable projects we have pending. And I'm working with Bruce McCormick to try to get some type of a communicator to Senator Nelson's office. And I would request the city to support the endeavor with a letter to Senator Nelson's office to the extent that he would lend his influence with Space Florida. As Space Florida has identified four regions in Florida where they're concentrating new technologies, which they'll be orchestrating and introducing, and spending money and hiring people and so forth. And we want Senator Nelson to make sure that whatever happens in our national forest and in the state forest, that we get some ground operations located in Carrabelle.
That's right.
Should we ask Mr. Hartman to prepare a letter?
I will be preparing the draft, and I'll give it to the city to be staffed and any modifications made, and Bruce McCormick's going to provide talking points to make sure that we're hitting all the things that the people receiving it need to hear for what we need to say. And the point, in the talk, one more point, economic development. When you look at what we don't have, that other people have, of deep sea ports, commercial airports, interstates, transportation, we have 85% of our county in forest land. And we need something that's compatible with us. And if we were ever going to have a perfect fit, having an educational facility, training people how to operate these unmanned vehicles, building them, testing them once they're built, training people on them when they come here, we're a perfect fit for that.
And I understand that's a green industry also.
It is something. Any concerns they have can be evaded. We can always, be sensitive to those. I mean, when you deal with electronics and stuff, there's certain ones, but, look at it this way. Whatever's going to be happening, and I tell folks, any kind of development, somebody's going to do this operation. It's either going to be in Bluntstown, it's going to be the east side or the west side of that forest area. We just want to make sure that we take all steps possible to try to get it here, where we have some good technical and some high-paying jobs. And people that do outdoors jobs now, they can go up into the forest to set out sensors and do things. They know the woods. So that's what we're trying to get. And the last thing is I'll be attending the Rural Economic Development Study presentation on April 18th at Bluntstown. That's the result of strategic planning and things we've done for rural economic development. Thank you. Any questions?
One thing, David, there were some signs of the parade still out on the highway a couple of days ago. Have they been picked up?
I got them today.
You got them? Good deal.
And I kept looking for that parade on Saturday because it said parade Saturday.
Well, yeah, some people stand up down the highway looking for a parade, and I'm just concerned about that.
Can we just change the event and make the parade Saturday?
Thank you.
Even though it gave the date, it didn't seem to make any sense.
Thank you, David.
Just a quick legal report, some interesting items. Quickly, one of them, Pickett's Landing or the fishing pier there. I've been had some conversations with Dan Ausley as well as email on an update on that. I expect him to be here at the next meeting to provide the update. Apparently, they ran into some trouble with DOT on the right-of-way, the bridge right-of-way over the river, so they had to move the pier over. It got into the riparian rights associated with the land that they have. They're working through all that in the General Counsel's Office of DEP, and he should be here at the next meeting to go over everything, progress, and anticipated completion date for that fishing pier at our next meeting. Yeah. So
it's actually making real progress?
Maybe. We'll see. I mean, when he's here with some paperwork, we will...
But is he selling? Yeah,
Phoenix Environmental's been working. I shouldn't be flipping. I mean, yes, they are making progress.
And we appreciate anything you can do in our neighborhood. We were expecting that in our neighborhood.
Yeah, we've been expecting it for years.
Yes.
I mean, way behind. But
now, did they understand he's selling that property?
Yes.
So
we can ask him. We can zero down on those.
We hear from very good sources in town that he's selling that property. So we need to be sure that the responsibility for carrying that out, you know.
It does. Commissioner Schneider is on top of that and that consulted with me. The agreement, the developer agreement that put all that into place, you know, it contains lawyer language like reasonable time periods and all that. And obviously it's arguable that he's beyond a reasonable time period to get this done. But the agreement is recorded. It is binding on all successors, assigns, all that, and people who buy that property. So, and it's recorded in the public record, so it runs with the land out there.
It is recorded.
Second item, just a consortium update. We have caused a little bit of a stir with the Gulf Consortium. They have a meeting tomorrow in Tallahassee. And this is the big meeting with 23 counties. We are on the agenda. There's agenda item 8. In which they will consider kind of the form, you know, whether or not to admit cities. They recognize our application to be admitted and are determining what conditions under which they will accept membership for municipalities. And it'll be interesting. The League of Cities, I was finally contacted by them today. We talked at length. They will be there to support us. So that's a good thing. The League of Cities is jumping on board.
I thought this was already a done deal where they denied your and then sent you to the store.
No, the lead up to this is this. We sent them a letter with our meeting all the prerequisites for membership. They sent back a letter saying that we could not be admitted as of right. Only the 23 counties could, but that they recognize our application, that we have met the prerequisites. They didn't go that far to say we met the prerequisites, but they said we will consider you for membership and some other platitudes. Nice. And they put it on the agenda for consideration at this meeting.
Is that matching it too?
Yes. So that they specifically mentioned cities of Carrabelle and Appalachia. They go through a relatively lengthy, in the agenda item, they have recommendations, analysis, that sort of thing. And one of their comments is that there are 104 cities in the 23 counties, and that it would become unwieldy to allow all cities to participate. They indicated that one thing they would consider, they don't have a solution yet, but they wanted to either have a committee consider and determine the conditions and type of membership and all that sort of thing. So it will be interesting, to say the least, tomorrow's meeting. It's right there in Tallahassee, so it's an easy one to go and monitor.
Dan, if I could add to that, it seems like that the Interlocal Act very clearly stated that after the initial 8 counties have formed and it becomes a legal entity, then membership can be made by various other agencies, including municipalities, by application and agreement to the Act, and then by a vote of the membership, and there's a certain percentage of that has to be done. And apparently, the fact that we decided to go in that direction apparently caught them by surprise. I don't know how in the world that got in there, and then they not expect that that might even be a possibility. So it sort of caught them off guard, and now they're, in my opinion, trying to regroup and see how to deal with it. And the word did get out that we had been turned down. And the truth is, we are not in the consortium yet. We have only applied, and that will be determined based on their policy as they define it, and the vote of the board, and so on and so forth. So that's what it's about. I'm sorry, Dan.
No, that's fine. And then the last item is, a number of months ago, I was kind of given direction by the board relative to the WMSI, St. George Island Utility stuff. I received a call last week, 1 minute phone call from the attorney for them, asking if we had any remaining interest in negotiating with them, talking with them, anything else. I indicated the ship had probably sailed, but that I was under direction from the commission to advise you if that happened. That was one of the things that we talked about at that meeting. So, and again, I just wanted to advise you.
Well, thank you. And it appears that he doesn't want to negotiate on that price that he had in the beginning. So.
Yeah, I mean, what I did was, of course, I told him I'm not authorizing for any charges. I'm not. I said I'd take it to y'all. They gave no indication of any of that. I mean, we went through a lot of negotiation with them and didn't get there before. I believe they negotiated with some of the island folks. They didn't get there. So, you know, certainly, I'm asking it right on directly to you all.
Balls
in that court.
If he calls again, tell him to come see us.
I mean, that's fine. I can tell them, come on in, send someone over.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll do that. I'll let him know that they need to send a representative here to address the commission. Sounds good. I'll do that. And that's it. The next item, Mr. Mayor, if you would adjourn the regular meeting, and we'll reconvene as the CRA.
I would adjourn the regular meeting and go in the...
And we'll just convene as the CRA board.
Yeah.
And we had expected the presentation from Carol Westmoreland. She's the executive director of Florida Redevelopment Association, kind of a subset of Florida League of Cities, regarding CRAs. She's the guru of CRAs statewide. And Commissioner LaPaz had done a lot of homework on the history of this Carrabelle CRA. And I don't want to steal any thunder, but the issues that were raised that I wanted to, or you can lay them on me,
no,
to address.
Go ahead.
The two issues are, it appears historically that in 2001, there was an amendment to the CRA, both a text amendment as well as an expansion of the territory. And it was asked, did that expansion, you know, what happened with it? The city has been operating the CRA board under the old 1992 territory up to this point. And the answer to that question is, in doing a little bit of research at the county and under Florida statutes, sections 163, 346, and 361, that if we did not, and it does not appear that in 2001 that we did, tell the taxing authority, which is the county, of that expansion, it's ineffective. Mm-hmm. That we don't collect, that we have no right to the revenue from that expanded area. It's a meets and bounds description. We have not had it mapped yet, so we don't know what that area is. Recommendation on that issue would be, and it's been on the kind of, I wouldn't say in progress because we stopped back in 2011, but there has been a very slowly percolating effort to update the CRA as far as text and territory. When we do that, we'll capture the old expansion as well as any new expansion. It would be the way to fix that problem or that confusion. The second issue, one other thing was, this is kind of timely, yesterday I got a letter from DEO requesting, making it known that there is money available for assistance, financial assistance to local governments like ours for planning efforts and that sort of thing, similar to what we've already gotten. I mean, we're working under that $50,000 one now. This one's a little smaller amounts of money, but might be perfect to put together a letter for some funding to assist with updates on the CRA.
So you can't, you can apply that grant funding to work on the update the plan and
yes, possibly. We can apply for it.
Mm-hmm. That would be good because that could be a little expensive.
Yeah, it would be expensive. Yeah.
That's a great idea. And what they're doing now is that.
What they're doing now, and I talked to Ray Greer about this because he's been a big help in getting grant monies and things out of DCA and the DEO. And his comment was that absolutely we should do that. It dovetails with the economic analysis and stuff they're doing now under our conference plan updates, year updates, all that. He said they can both support each other and it makes a lot of sense to do it now. So we can apply for it. The other one would be, and we can, if we were turned down, we can try and fold some of it under the funding we are getting, $50,000. Because that we aren't using. There's still a little bit of room there, too.
Dan, could you, for some people that may not be familiar with the CRA, could you just like say the words and talk about it is for a couple of sentences?
Sure. It in the packet is a nice PowerPoint presentation that Carol Smolin does, but in simple terms, it is a geographic area they spell out, usually in a downtown area of the city, that's in need of economic or just physical revitalization. And they usually talk about slums or blight. You know, we're a small town, we don't necessarily have that, but we have areas that need a facelift and that sort of thing. And the neat trick about it is that the way it works as far as a funding mechanism is you establish what's called a base year. And our base year for our CRA, as it stands, is 1992. And what happens is we are entitled to basically all of the taxes, tax increment above our base year, so taxes assessed, both county and city. So the county and city, we get up to the, let's say a piece of properties in 1992 was $100,000, and today it's worth $200,000. We collect all of the increment on that second, on that $200,000, taking it to $200,000. That's a lot of revenue, and it goes into a fund, a separate standalone fund, and can be spent on only projects projects in the CRA. So it has to be spent in that area that generated that money. And the projects that it can be spent on are outlined both by statute and the plan. That you have a CRA plan, and again, ours is 1982, so it's older, but it's actually interesting to read it because it talks a lot about the Riverwalk. I mean, a lot of what was done downtown was, not all of it was done with CRA money, but the vision was in the CRA plan for a lot of what was done. And it's a very, it's just an excellent funding source, and, again, sort of interesting is you say, well, why wouldn't you designate more area to be a CRA? Because it's basically city citizens, city landowners, a lot of our tax money goes to the county. And that's a good, the county provides services or anything, but the city does too. And this money can be spent on, like they did, on Marine Street roads, obviously land acquisition, water, sewer, stormwater, all kinds of things to improve the CRA area. And that's the reason why you would want to expand the CRA. Some cities tried to declare their whole city a CRA, and the counties objected, and it was shot down. But many cities have CRAs that cover up a large portion of the city for obvious reasons. We had an effort back in 2010, 2011 to update the CRA. And I've talked to Carol about this for a couple of years, as well as Greg Greer, is that we're in an epic time to expand our CRA territory. There's a lot of folks that set them up in 2005 or 6. They're 40, 50% below their base year now. So they'll spend 15 years catching up to their base year. There's no income. They have no income. We still have income because we set it up in 92. again, in my opinion, but I think, you know, property values have dropped to almost 90, early 90s prices, late 80s prices. When the property values stop dropping, and we don't have to guess it perfect, but talking to the property appraiser and that sort of thing, that's the time to expand. If we expand our territory then we'll enjoy the increase in years to come and have substantial revenue to our CRA. And saying that, our 1992 base will always apply to the current CRA area. When we expand, we will set a base year for that expanded area. So now we'll have two base years. So expanding it, the timing of expansion is very important.
And two, is there a time frame when the money has to be spent out of that fund?
There is not.
Okay.
But the I read in the statute that the CRA district or territory or the whole organization of the special district can be, it lasts for 30 years. And you have to apply to extend that out.
Thank you. Yeah, renew it. And
yes.
Yeah.
Redraw it.
I would like to add, you know, this plan, it wasn't readily available. A lot of folks have never seen it, the actual plan. And I'm wondering if the commissioners, if they haven't seen it, could we, you know, provide this to all of the commissioners? And then, as well as, the resolution that was a little bit, the 032001, you said they weren't taxing on that legal map change description, but what about the update that's in there? Did that apply?
Yes, we did not receive, I don't believe, the tax increment from the expansion of the territory back in 2001. Uh-huh. Because the taxing authority, we didn't follow through on that.
Yeah.
The tax changes would be in effect.
Okay, so then have them also, everybody get a copy of this so they can see what the, you know, what the updates are to, you know, to the plan. Because, you know, it's like you say, it's good history. Actually in here it refers to a big project for the old Carrabelle gym and gives funding, like, you know, all the, not design, but funding on it, and the old Carrabelle gym is long gone, so this needs serious updating.
Yeah, the reason we started the process back in 2010 was because what was DCA at the time said, hey, guys, your plan's old, you need to update it. And the idea at the time was to do both, do the territory, not do everything twice, not do a text update and a territory update, do them wrapped up in one. And of course, the territory update is what kind of controlled it is that if you would increase the territory, if your base year was 2010, you've had a 25% decrease since 2010. Can we mean that we'd not be happy if we had a base year of 2010?
And so, then if staff would also make sure they have this map here for all, since I've been on board here, I thought it was the comprehensive plan, the red that's in the comprehensive plan, which is not the same as this map.
Yeah,
so I don't know how. We think that's an error.
That's an error. The CRA map in the comp plan should match with the map on the plan, and Wilson Miller might have got that wrong. Mm-hmm.
And yet this is the map from the property appraiser. What's the end of the map? What's included and being tagged?
And Keisha has the best map right there.
And is it all of Marine Street? And then
all the way to the bridge.
On both sides of the road.
So it's the waterfront. The waterfront from the bridge to down to
the
boat ramp. The boat ramp on both sides of the road.
The dog out and conservatory dog.
Well, before we, are we about to adjourn, do you think?
Yeah, if we don't.
Well, I just wanted to address one item. I'm not real clear, you know, if it's in the plan or not, but we have used, this commission, we've used public funds to purchase a property at 400 Marine Street that needs some attention at this point to stabilize it. And I'm wondering if, you know, I might make a motion to stabilize the roof, a minor patch repair there to keep it from having any more damage to protect the investors of the taxpayers. Something that would be like, we remove the shingles and replace the damaged roof decking and then put new shingles back there on that southwest corner just to keep the eave and the soffit from falling in any further than it is.
But just that.
You're going to make that a motion.
Yes, sir. That, what do you think about that?
Can I get a second?
I'll second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
If opposed, get gone. That's a good idea.
We got to get that stabilized.
Yeah.
Maybe the thing to do, bring Russell into this, is to get bids. Get bids on the work. We can have at the next meeting, we can do one of these sections again and have everybody review those.
But do you think it will cost that much? Something like that might, it may not, it's just a minor patch repair. I'm thinking about $1,000 somewhere in there, not major. I would think our city administrator could handle that possibly. You know, if it's under 25 months ago.
We need to bid it.
Okay.
Okay, so do we.
Right, and you could adjourn the.
Call it right, you'll be back to order.
All right, I've got her this one. Good. Okay. We're back at the regular public hearing of the commission. We have three proclamations. First proclamation 02-2013. Whereas clean, safe, and sustainable water resources and supplies are vital to the city of Carrabelle's economy, environment, and its people. And whereas the state of Florida Water Management District and the city of Carrabelle are working together to increase awareness about the importance of water conservation. And whereas the city of Carrabelle and the state of Florida have designated April typically a dry month when water demands are most acute as Water Conservation Month to educate citizens about saving precious water resources. And whereas the city of Carrabelle is committed to setting a good example for its citizens regarding water conservation. And whereas every business, industry, school, and citizen can make a difference when it comes to conserving water. Now, therefore, we, the Commission of City Carrabelle, Florida, do hereby proclaim April 2013 as Water Conservation Month in the City of Carrabelle and urge all residents and businesses to help protect our precious water resources by practicing water-saving measures. And if everyone's in agreement with it, we could have a vote to so proclaim.
Can I get a motion?
I make a motion. We proclaim Thursday, April 2013 as our.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
right. Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
It goes.
The next one, proclamation 03-2013, whereas the Carrabelle River is the heart of the city of Carrabelle, whereas April 13th is Carrabelle River Cleanup Day, whereas April 26th and 27th is Carrabelle Riverfront Festival, whereas the entire city of Carrabelle is in the watershed of the Carrabelle River, whereas keeping the watershed clean protects our drinking water, improves the water we work in, and helps the water we play in, whereas a clean community adds to the quality of our life. Therefore, we, the City Commission of Carrabelle, do hereby proclaim April as Clean Up Carrabelle Month. And this was the proclamation we talked about relative to code enforcement and moving forward with getting things cleaned up. So a motion to...
Get a motion.
Moved to approve.
I need a motion. Get a second.
I'll second it.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
It's counted.
Aye.
And proclamation 04-2013, whereas the entire community can inspire, equip, and mobilize people to take action that changes the world, and whereas individuals and communities are at the center of social change, discovering their power to make a difference, and whereas during the week of April 21 through 27, 2013, all over the nation, service projects will be performed and volunteers recognized for their commitment to service, and whereas the giving of oneself in service to another empowers the giver and the recipient, whereas our country's volunteer force of over 63 million is a great treasure, and whereas volunteers are vital to our future as a caring and productive nation, and now therefore be it resolved, the mayor and Carrabelle City Commissioners do hereby proclaim April 21 through 27, 2013 as National Volunteer Week in the City of Carrabelle, and also urge
our fellow citizens to volunteer in Franklin County and the city of Carrabelle by volunteering and recognizing those who serve by tirelessly sharing their time and talent with those in need.
I motion that April 21st through the 27th, Carrabelle proclaim that National Volunteer Week.
Get a second.
I second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's gone.
If anybody needs any suggestions as to what they might do that week for volunteers, we've got a list, so check with me.
Another now, here's a resolution number 03-2013. City Carrabelle. Whereas, as a part of the continual updating of the Florida or state of Florida highway system, the Department of Transportation of the state of Florida, for the purpose of safety, protection of the investment, and other reasons, has constructed and does maintain highway facilities, specifically US 98, within the corporate limits of the city of Carrabelle. And whereas the Lakeside Beautification Assistance Program has been created by Section 334.044, sub 26, Florida statutes to provide for the conservation of natural roadside growth and scenery, and for the implementation and maintenance of roadside beautification programs. And whereas the City of Carrabelle desires to participate in this roadside beautification assistance program for the enjoyment of its citizens and others, and has made application therefore and received notice of award thereof. And whereas the City of Carrabelle and the Department of Transportation mutually recognize the need for an agreement providing for the planning and completion of this roadside beautification project, a copy of which is attached hereto and made a part hereof. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City of Carrabelle desires to enter into such agreement and has authorized its officers to do so.
Move to approve. Need a motion.
Cal did, and I'll second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? If not. Okay.
Last legislative item here is City of Carrabelle Ordinance number 456, an ordinance of the City of Carrabelle. By title here, an ordinance of the City of Carrabelle, Florida, providing for amendment of Ordinance 389 pertaining to code enforcement powers, procedures, and notices in the City of Carrabelle, providing for severability and establishing an effective date. This is an amendment to Ordinance 389. This is Ordinance 456. The amendment is to extend the lien period to the statutory maximum of 20 years from 5 on folks who are in violation, found to be in violation of code enforcement.
Yeah.
And it's first reading, no actions required.
Okay.
Old business, item one, discussion and possible action concerning the special exception to replace a mobile home in a single has been removed. Item two, discussion and possible action concerning maintenance contract on landscape, requested by Brennan Walden.
What happened with one?
It was removed. Mm-hmm.
That when you come off the Carrabelle Bridge, all the palm trees and all the way to the Carrabelle Junction on both sides of the road, I'm just going to do three main things. Just cut the grass, blow off, trim the palm trees, just keep maintenance up, basically. And I talk to them. That's what the bid consists of, me doing. And I get paid every month, and I come by every two weeks. You know what I'm saying? Two times a month, and I come in and the county commission said don't do the red cedar mulch that is coming down on the highway on 98. They'll have that, so I don't have to pay for that, and I just help replace it. So I'm asking if I could get that bid.
There's two bids here. One says 75 and one says 200. So what are we looking at?
Well, on the bottom it says one of them are just doing the palm trees.
Oh, palm trees only.
On
thank
the
you.
Bottom.
Okay, handwritten in there. Okay, so he wants $200 a month and then an additional fee of $350 to begin the contract. Has he met with our roads? Have you met with our roads and department supervisor, Mr. Massey, William Massey?
Yeah, I've actually talked to him, but I had to call the meeting off last month because I was kind of busy. It was March 4th, but I was kind of busy, so I came here because we were scheduled.
No, but you've talked with William.
Yeah, I've already talked. Mm-hmm. That's who told me about the red cedar mulch.
Uh-huh.
That's who told me about that. They'll supply that.
We do have some extra money in the Parks and Recs budget, and it does need a little more attention than they do get to give to it.
And I'd like to know about what Mr. Cowell was about to ask.
I was just asking if William didn't know about it, and of course, they're overworked, can't keep up with everything anyway, so yeah, this will be part-time help to take care of the slide. I move that we accept this.
Can I come down on that?
From just a legal perspective, I would probably draw up some documentation on it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I understand this could form the basis for as far as the terms, but I'll...
I would think we would need to know if he's going to give us notice or we're going to give him notice.
Basically, like every month, I was kind of tied up first to the 10th, then 15th, like the 15th every month, and so forth, I'll be open. So
who's going to be the boss man that night?
What is it?
Who knows what your ticket could do to us?
William. William.
Okay.
Well, isn't he subcontracting? William would. He could get information from William, but he's subcontracting.
Right, he has his own business.
Right, his own business.
A copy of his cards on that. I would amend the motion to have Mr. Hartman draw up just a legal contract for a contract to subcontract.
I'll agree with that.
Could I ask without a take price?
I'll accept that amendment. Second the amendment.
Okay, thank you. Ask Mr. Hartman how long it would take him to draw that up.
I'll call him. He says if he comes in, and I'll call him.
He didn't vote on it, guys.
I got an amended motion.
Yes.
Do I have a second?
Yes. All right, second to the amendment.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
It counts.
Discussion and possible action concerning appointing a new code enforcement special master.
I put some stuff in your packets. This is Mr. Anderson here, and he is from Georgia. He's retired from code enforcement, and right now we don't have a special master, so we kind of need one. We have supposed to appoint one every 2 years.
Okay.
Is there a requirement that they live within the state?
He lives here now.
Okay.
I read over all of your certificates here. You could stand to be a volunteer fireman.
You want to include that in your work?
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, Commissioners, I'm Ken Anderson. I purchased my home here in the 80s because by that time I'd already decided I wanted to live in your community. I retired as the...
Glad to have you.
Sir?
Glad to have you.
Well, thank you, sir. I am glad to be here. I retired in Ben Hill County as the code enforcement officer. I served on the state board elected by the code enforcement as treasurer of term. I got my degree from the University of Georgia in code enforcement. I was also the chief building inspector while I was up there, so I do know a little bit about the building also. And I would be proud to serve if you decide you want me. Is anyone?
I think it would be fabulous. I'd be very stoked to get someone of this caliber wanting to help us out.
And I get a motion to step
that. You're still qualified. We don't want you running off somewhere else.
Wait a minute. We got a motion to step that. And can I get a second?
I'll second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's gone.
Thank you, Mr. Andrews.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
I'll do more.
Discussion and possible action concerning a temporary beer and wine permit for the Big Ben Saltwater Classic on June 14th through the 16th.
Make a motion to approve.
I'll second that.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
It's gone.
Discussion and possible action concerning a water bill for 322 River Road requested by Tara Norick.
Well,
It's my first county commission meeting, or city commission meeting. I'm very impressed. It was very enjoyable. Well done. I'm Judy Paul. I'm at 347.
Can you use the microphone, please?
So, Mom,
is it on?
Yes. Yeah. I'm Judy Paul, and I live at 347 River Road here in Carrabelle. I've owned this house for 17 years. And 4 years ago, my daughter decided she wanted to retire down here, so she bought a house there at 322 River Road. But until she's ready to retire, she's been renting it out. And the problem before you is that, I'll be very brief because I know everybody's getting tired here, is that she never requested that her water be turned on at any time. So she was very surprised when she got a bill for $1,231.62 last June. And on it, it states it was for services from May 15th, 2012 to June 2015. And then that's the only thing she's ever received. She never got a bill before that. She never got a bill after that. And she immediately called and contested the bill and was told that she would hear back, but she never did. So this January, she asked for the water to be turned on so that she could clean the house and rent it again. And she was told she had to pay $600 in order to get her water on and then appeal this bill to the city commission. And do you all have a copy of that letter that she wrote? She has written a letter explaining all this in more detail. My only observation is that my husband Len and I have been on River Road 17 years. We missed a payment once, and man, that water was cut off immediately. And I don't understand how a bill could have run up over $1,200 without her ever being notified, without her receiving a bill. And we're just asking that she not be required to pay this $1,200 bill. Now, apparently there were other people living there at the house at the time, and we believe that the billing should have gone to them and not to her.
Okay, I got a couple things to say. I have an application here actually filled out by Ms. Hall in 2009 for the water to be turned on. And it was turned on the 6th, on the 9th, or on the 20th.
What month are you talking about?
This was February of 2009.
Okay.
And then on the 26, one of her tenants come in, and she couldn't afford the deposit, so Miss Norick agreed to let the deposit go on to the tenant's account. So she called and turned that off in February of 2010. When she turned the water, she had the water turned off.
Miss Hall had the water.
No, Charlene, the renter.
The renter.
Because it was now in her name.
Yes.
The account was
because
now in her name.
Allowed it to be transferred over. And Ms. Wilson even received part of the deposit back that had originally belonged to Ms.
After
Hall.
The bill was paid. So after that, it stayed off. We had it turned off.
Mm-hmm.
Well, somehow it got turned back on, and there were several other renters for 2 years. And we found it on an orphan read because we don't know that it's running if we can't catch it. We do audits every now and then. We called it. We went and turned it off. Well, Miss Norick called Renee and said, do not charge my tenants that bill. That is my bill. Do not charge them. So we set her account back up and sent the bill to her. There was 110,000 gallons that went through that meter in the 2 years. We didn't charge her the minimum bills that everybody else pays monthly on top of the usage. We just sent her one bill with all the usage on it. and...
So they didn't get the base rate each month?
Each month, right.
They just got one base rate?
If she would have been paying a bill like she was supposed to, she would have been paying a base rate on top of that usage.
So they haven't given a break.
And plus there, I understand, no late fees and such.
Right, so then we took the reading of when we turned Charlene off and the reading of when we caught that water on, and we billed her for that because she was insistent, and Renee is here to tell you, that do not charge my tenants. So we took that reading and started her tenants, their own account.
Right.
And they paid from there on out.
Is there a, how can they turn the meter on? How did they do that?
It's just a little valve.
But there was no record of anybody coming to the city to turn it on.
Yeah, and it does, that particular meter doesn't lock. Should we put a lock meter out there?
Well, she had no idea that meter had been turned on.
Ma'am, I'd like to ask you, it's in 2 years here. And why that nobody paid any attention to this for 2 years? There's something wrong here. I don't know where it's at.
I agree.
But I don't believe that if I owned the house and somebody else was living in it and using my water, I'd find out how they got there and all of that. Because this is something wrong here somewhere. I don't know what it is, but it's wrong because they could have, somebody on that house ought to know. Somebody did know. I'll put it that way.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to know who was billed, because she never got a bill.
No one was billed.
No one was
billed. Because
the city
wasn't aware. The city was not aware that the water was even being used.
Because it was turned off.
Well, then why is she responsible?
Because she is the property owner. She collected the rent. She is the property owner. If I rent you my house tomorrow, okay, and you even come out to the city and put up a water deposit, and you leave owing more than what that deposit was, it is my financial obligation as the owner of that property to pay the rest of that bill.
Excuse me, that's not correct.
Oh, it is?
We have rental property. The water is turned on in that tenant's name.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's right. As the owner, we are not responsible for what they use. It's the responsibility of the tenant.
Okay.
This was over 10 years.
Right.
She had several tenants in and out of here. We have no responsibility for the tenant, not the homeowner.
Who she had in there at the time.
Well, then the responsibility back to the tenant. But at the same time, the city's not responsible for her tenants being in there using water.
Then you need to go to the tenants to recoup.
We don't
right. Yeah. You've got to go to the tenants.
How do we even know what months and what to charge what tenants with? The city doesn't rent the property, the owner does. And I just find that hard to believe.
Well,
taxpayers in Carrabelle are responsible for all the vacation rentals.
Yeah, as a legal matter.
I'll put it on your shoulders.
All right, as a legal matter, if I understand what you're saying, Ms. Cox, and if your tenant opens up an account in their name, they are responsible for that account. In this situation, we have a meter that's turned off at the city. Someone is, and again, I'm going to like, but they are stealing water. They have turned on a meter that's off. No one's opened up an account. That meter, it is no different than a leak on that property. Or it is different because actually they're using both water and sewer. But it is the property owner's responsibility to go after, if your tenants were using that water, you have a lease with them, you need to enforce that lease. The city is not a party to the lease, so the owner of the property received rental income that was supposed to cover, or not, that money.
But there was no bill. Nobody ever got a bill.
Because the landowner's tenants were essentially stealing water. I mean, that's not...
But how can she be responsible for them stealing water?
Why should the city be?
She's rich. Those are her tenants, not the city.
She said that there was another tenant that we're not even aware of that rented it as well, that obviously never came in and set up their account. So we don't know which tenant used what amounts of what water.
The city's not responsible for the tenants. We're not.
She
doesn't, if she had gotten a bill, she would have paid it.
A lot of landlords will call and say, did my tenant set up an water account?
Well, why wasn't the water turned off?
It was turned off.
Why was it turned off?
It was off. It was off and off. I have a work order.
How could it run?
Somebody had to turn it off. They cut locks all the time. They manipulate the meters. We can pull the meters out and they still get water.
But there's no evidence that that occurred in this case. I think that the city made a mistake.
It was signed off by John Lee.
Why would you make a mistake, ma'am?
Who was reading?
Pardon?
Why wouldn't it be her fault?
Whose?
The city of Carrabelle. Why would it be her fault?
Because they didn't bill anybody. Water is being used.
We didn't know water was being used.
Yeah, but we don't know.
110 gallons.
We have 1,600 water.
We don't read the meters if there's not an account set up.
Every meter, every day and see what it's doing.
And so the water could just run forever. It could be years and years and years.
We've actually discovered that.
All these new electronic meters, we get a report that now that we can do an orphan read and we can track, we have to track that meter down. We can tell it's running somewhere, but we have to track it down because there's no account set up to trace that meter.
Well, she legally, in her lease, said tenant is responsible for the utilities.
But that's between her and her tenants. It has nothing to do with the city.
That's right. No, ma'am, one thing.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Didn't you say that this lady had the meter turned off?
No, her other tenants. Well, there's several tenants in there. And that's how the water got cut off.
All right, from what I'm understanding, the owner had the water turned off.
No.
No, the tenant did.
Well, you can't have water in two people's names. So then it was actually in the tenant's name.
It was in one of the tenants. This is a period of like 4 years.
But it would be as of the record of the last person that had that water legally turned on.
That was the tenant, Charlene.
The tenant, and you need to go after the tenant.
When she moved out, she called and said, I'm moving out. Turn the water off in my home.
It's not for us to go after the tenant. It's for her to go after.
Well, what does she have to do? Go check the meter every month to make sure somebody isn't stealing?
She's got a tenant and she needs to make for sure that, you know, either she has an account or that they have an account.
Yes.
So all landlords for this whole city of Carrabelle
need to be responsible for their tenants.
If they steal water, the landlord's responsible.
They need to be responsible for their tenants.
It would be similar, I'm thinking, as if they used electricity. You couldn't really go to Progress Energy and ask them to forgive the bill. Progress Energy would put the bill on the property owner.
The last person that had that meter. No, it's the last person who turned the meter.
I had it on my property from.
The city is not in the business of determining whether a house is being rented, leased, owner occupied, anything like that. There's a lease that the owner had with their tenant. They received rent under it, under the lease. What you're telling us, and I saw a copy of the lease, says that the tenants will be responsible for water. They put a tenant in the home that stole water for 2 years. The responsibility does not fall back on the city for that.
And those tenants wasn't even there for the whole 2 years that it was off, that was supposedly off. Yeah. They was only in there a partial time, and then it was used before they moved in too. So that's, we can't determine who used all the water.
That 2 years is what I can't figure. Why didn't somebody check the house?
And how did it get turned?
They don't check every vacant house. They don't go by and check every vacant.
I mean the one that owned the house is who I'm talking about.
Right.
Not the city. It ain't their place.
So I have to go check every month. I have to go read the meter.
Ma'am, just a simple phone call to the city. I own this address.
There's someone living there. Do they have an account?
That are moving in there. Or have they come in and set up their water deposit correctly as they should?
Yeah.
Well, what Keisha said is somehow it got turned back on.
Maybe the tenant did it. It wasn't the city that did it because we were required a deposit.
That's right.
And I've told her we would work with her and give her a payment plan. She could pay a little bit on top of her bill extra until she gets this paid off. We haven't been charging her the late fees. We really tried to work with her,
Well, it's just a shock to get a bill one day for $1,200 that you knew nothing about. And it just doesn't seem right. And now that you have a system, right, that will pick up on that.
Only on the new meters that we're slowly replacing all these out.
So I don't think she should have to suffer for the fact that new equipment wasn't there. And I appreciate your time. And whatever the commission rules, of course, we will accept that. But it just seems like a very unfair situation. Thank you.
Is this covered anywhere in your ordinances or statutes someplace?
And I asked about that. With more rentals coming into the area, maybe we should have something set up when people are renting their property.
It would have nothing to do with rentals. It would have to do with the water. When you set up an account, the city sets up the water account. They get a name, they get a deposit, correct?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
All right. So when that water is turned on, it's in their name. If they leave without having the water turned off, another three or four people come in, that same person is responsible for that bill because you never turned it off.
When they turns it off before it ever gets that far.
We're not saying that you normally do, but this time something happened.
There was not an account set up at all.
The last person that set up that account had it turned off
in 2009.
And got a deposit check back.
All right, so you think nobody.
And nobody else.
And nobody came in.
Somebody cut the lock.
We
also have a responsibility. I think there's partial responsibility.
But also, the state that I am in Georgia is fixing to make all revenue be checked to show not only what goes out of your well, which you have to take a well reading daily, and it'll show not only what goes out, but you have to show how many gallons you total your used water to your amount left out of the well, and it shows you how many gallons left.
When we have a record of the reading when it was cut off and locked, then we got a reading when we found the water being used.
How did you find the water being used?
We was doing audits of every house, and then they'll bring in a sheet. And we see that it hasn't been turned off.
Was she the only person who got billed like this?
No, there's been others that has not had accounts set up and had tenants through there, and
I think this lady's confusing the fact.
Somebody's responsible for the water. Unfortunately, she got left
and cut the lock.
And she was determined. Now, we would have charged them tenants when they were still in there, but she said, no, do not charge them. Because we were going to charge it to the tenants.
She didn't.
She did too, Renee. She said, do not charge my tenants because we were going to charge the tenants. And she said, no, it's not their responsibility. So we set the tenants up that day forward.
Right. In whose name?
In the tenant's name.
Then why she has nothing to do with that then?
She has to do with the tenant.
She has the 2 years. She didn't want us to charge the tenant. You said
that. The public couldn't just.
But she turned it.
Couldn't speak without being recognized.
And she obviously it was requested to be turned on because it says date to be turned on 2/6/09, and I have a work order where it was. This was. And it's got a copy of your driver's license.
Now, so we need
that
you're saying?
Yes.
Are you a newspaper or Because I want to tell you something.
This is, again, a different set of circumstances, but similar to many of the other issues that have come before the commission, mostly on leaks. So the commission certainly has the discretion to adjust the amount or leave the amount as is. That's
now we'll so, be quiet.
I mean, it's certainly the commission's pleasure of whether or not to consider this amount due from the property owner.
Well, she is paid $600.
She's paid $600.
So if you could forgive the other $600, that would be
great. I know people come in here with water leaks, and I feel desperately sorry for them. They're on fixed incomes. And the only thing that I can do then is chop off the sewer because they have a bona fide leak, and they've proven it to me. This is a rental home. If I can't adjust my senior citizen or my single mom's water bill to give them any credit, I'm not going to give them any credit on this one.
But that's for people who are in their name.
Yes, ma'am. That makes sure their tenants aren't stealing from the city.
What if we need a motion or what?
Yes.
All right, we need a motion.
A motion for what? I make a motion that we arrange and help her with her, you know, setting up monthly payments on this, but I make a motion that the bill be paid in full.
Second. I've got a motion and a second. Now, all in favor say aye.
Any discussion?
Aye.
One last thing, y'all got a copy of the bills. Did anybody yes. have any comments or anything?
There was a misprint on dates there because we're not in 2015.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was a misprint that got sent out to everybody.
Yeah,
nobody talked about
it.
Yeah.
But as far as the bills we gave you for the month, y'all have to review.
Talking about other bills.
Yeah.
In light of the revenue for sewer and water, I was asking a question about a person who's been receiving water for 1 month, 2 years, and never paid a bill. Where is the criminality of someone taking something from the city and not paying? And my understanding is unless you catch them altering the meter, you don't have a case in court. Can we not put a public notice in the paper that if you're receiving water and you are not paying for it, it is a criminal offense. And then if you catch someone...
Well, maybe it.
Well, it may be, but evidently there's not a clean legal way to enforce it and hold someone criminally liable.
I attended a little workshop with Florida Rural Water Association, and that was a major topic of discussion. And there were water department supervisors there, and they say legally you have to actually catch the person in the act of turning the water on or hooking a pipe up to the water main or a hose or something. You actually have to see that happen to press charges.
So they had
the documentation.
What it is, they
had it has to be documented.
They had to, somebody used the water. There's no doubt ever who was in this house. If I own something, I'm going to find out the next day or next week. If my rent ain't paid or my debt, I'm going to find out more about it and cut it out.
But how would she know? How would she know it wasn't paid?
Ma'am?
I would suggest to her, if she rents it out, to call and verify that the utilities have been set up. If she moves out, call and verify that if somebody else moves in, call and verify that the utilities are set up. She shouldn't have to do that, but unfortunately.
We done voted down it. That's code enforcement.
I make a motion to adjourn.
All in favor, say aye.